Hello everyone, my name is Niketan Dubaria and here I am welcoming you to the video lecture series of Basic Electrical Engineering. Have you ever thought that why electricity is the popular source of energy? Here we have various types of source of energy, but still why electricity is the most popular source of energy and it is widely used all over the world. There are various reasons behind that. Let's see one of them. Electricity, is it the most convenient and easy form of energy which can be converted into any other form of energy? Like if you need light, then you can convert electricity into light easily and efficiently. Same way, if you need any kind of mechanical energy in form of rotation, in form of force, in form of movement, again you can convert electricity into that motion, into that velocity, into that force, and that is again very easily and efficiently. More one example, if you need heat, again you can convert electricity in form of heat, again very easily and efficiently. And this is the one of the major reason why electricity is widely used. And one another reason, and that is again it is very easy, convenient and efficient to transmit electricity at long distance. If we use any other form of energy and if we need to transmit that form of energy at long distance, then there is no comparison with electricity. And one more thing, if you opt computer engineering, IT engineering, civil, automobile, mechanical, chemical or any other branch, but still this is very important for you. And why? Because as a computer engineer, civil engineer or a mechanical or an automobile engineer, whenever we are going to work on any machines or maybe in any environment, if you will look surrounding you, then you will find all machines will be working on electricity. So this is a simple reason, whatever you are opting, but still you have to deal with electricity, and that's why it is very important to study the subject, and that is basic electrical engineering. So by considering this importance, let's start the first chapter of basic electrical engineering, and that is DC circuits. And here we have a contents of DC circuits. Here we will start with basic circuit elements like what is resistance, what is inductance, what is capacitance, how it is constructed, how it works. Next we will discuss various sources of electricity, means various voltage source, various current source. And next we will discuss various laws like Kirchhoff's voltage law, Kirchhoff's current law, as well as Ohm's law. This will be discussed in this video lecture series. Next we will discuss and analyze various DC circuits like series circuit, parallel circuit, circuit based on star and delta connections. Next we will discuss various theorems by which we can analyze or solve any electrical circuit, like superposition theorem, Thevenin theorem, Norton theorem. So these three theorems will be discussed in this video lecture series. Next we will discuss time domain analysis of first order RL and RC series circuit. This is nothing but charging and discharging of inductor as well as the capacitor. So basically these are the contents of chapter number 1. Here in this first video we are going to start our first topic of our first chapter, DC circuits. And in our first video lecture I am going to introduce with basic terms of electricity which are given over here, like what is charge, what is current, what is potential, what is potential difference and many more. So these terms are going to be discussed in this video. So let's start with the first term, and that is electric charge. Before we discuss what is charge, first of all let's discuss the basic structure of atom. We know that any materials forms of small particles which are known as atoms. So this is the basic structure of any atom, and we know that atom is form of three particles: neutron, proton and electron. At the center part of atom, which is known as a nucleus, it contains two particles, neutron as well as proton, and electrons are in outer orbit, means electrons are rotating in outer orbits surrounding the nucleus as shown in this diagram. And one more thing, we know that protons are positively charged particles, electrons are negatively charged particles, and neutrons are in neutral condition. And we know that positive charge on one proton is equal to the negative charge on one electron. And if we are assuming that if number of protons and number of electrons on this atom are same, that means on this atom positive as well as negative charge is same, so this will form a neutral atom. If let's assume that by providing external force, if we pull out one of the electrons out of this atom, then this remaining atom will form a positive charge. Why? Because in our previous condition we had same number of proton and same number of electron. We just pull out the one negative charge, so there is a absence of some negative charge, and that makes that atom a positive charge body. And similarly, that free electron which was pulled out of that atom, that will form a negative charge body, means negative particle. So you can form a positive and negative charge body by maintaining the number of protons and number of electrons on that body. If number of protons will be more with compared to number of electrons on some particular body, that body will form positive charge. And if on some particular body number of electrons will be more with compared to number of positive charge protons, then that body will form as a negative charge body. So this is the how we can form positive or negative charge. And let's discuss the theory further. This is again same diagram. Again we have a nucleus, and surrounding that nucleus we have electrons on those orbits, and most outer orbits, which is known as the valence band or valence shell, and electrons which are in that valence shell, that are known as a valence electron. And that are the electrons which is loosely bound with nucleus, means if you are providing some external force, external energy to that atom, you can easily free those electrons which are on valence band, which are known as a valence electron. So let's suppose that if we are providing some external energy in form of electric in form of heat, or maybe in form of electrostatic force, so by that external force you can pull out the electrons out of that valence band. So now we will have two separate bodies. First one atom which is having absence of negative charge, so that will form a positive charge, and those free electrons which was pulled out, that will form negative charge body. So this is the method how we can form negative or positive charge. Now let's move towards the next term, and that is potential. First of all, what is potential in general term? Potential means ability of any body to do work, and we also know that work is also done to charge that body, and that work done is also known as a potential. Now here we have three charged bodies. If you put two same charged bodies, let's say if we are putting positive and positive charged body together, they will apply force on each other, and force will be a repulsive force. And that's why here we can observe that in this diagram two positive charge are moving away from each other. Same way this positive and negative charge bodies are attracting each other. So basically these are the charge bodies which are applying force on each other, and they are moving each other. Basically, they are providing or applying work or energy to each other, and this ability of these bodies are known as the potential of these bodies. So basically, what is potential? And that can be defined as the charged body has ability to do work, and this ability is known as the potential of these bodies. And again, ability of the charged body to do work is known as a electrical potential. So here, ability of this charged particle to apply the force on another charged particle, that ability of this charged particle is electrical potential for this charged bodies. And mathematically, that can be defined by this equation. Potential is defined in form of voltage. So V is equal to work done per charge, means how much energy or work done is applied per charge. That parameter is known as the electrical potential. So this was the electrical potential. Now next, move towards the electrical potential in just another way. Here again, we have one positively charged body. That means that will form a medium surrounding that body, and that is known as the electrical field of that body. If we put just another charge surrounding that charge, so this positive charge will apply force on another charge, and this region is known as the electrical field of that charged body. And now let's suppose we have another body over here which is on R point. So this positive charge Q will apply force on this charge, and let's say that if because of that force, now this another body which is in blue color, which is moving from this R point to that P point, and here if we need to define potential at this P point, so that can be defined by whatever work done is applied to move that charge from this R point to that P point. That work done per charge will define potential on that P point. If this blue colored body will be negative charge, then this positive charge will attract that body. And let's say if this will be positive charge, so as these are the same charges, then on that condition that will repel the charge. But basically, when we define electrical potential, so that can be defined by the work done provided per charge to move another charge from one point to another point. That defines electrical potential on that particular point. So here we have a definition of electrical potential, and that is work done in moving a charge from point R to point P. That is defined as an electrical potential. Now let's move towards the another definition, that is potential difference. Here we have same diagram, but now we had just assumed that this another charge which is at infinite distance with compared to that Q charge. Now let's assume that we are moving that charge from this infinite distance to that first point, and let's define that this first point is point A. So based on that, we can define potential on that point A as a VA. And if we are moving this same charge from infinite to another point, and let's define that as point B, and based on that we can define potential of that second point, that is VB. So now we have two points, and on those two points we have defined potential individually, potential VA and potential VB. So here, by finding the difference between two potential on point A and point B, we can define the potential difference, and that can be defined by VB minus VA or VA minus VB. So this is the potential difference. What is potential difference? That is the difference between potentials on two points. So let's move toward the next definition, and that is EMF, electromotive force. What is electromotive force? A force required to move electron from negative terminal of source to positive terminal of source, that force is defined as EMF, electromotive force. Here we have one diagram in which we have one conductor and that is connected with a DC source over here. And here this red color dots which is representing a charge, means a free electron. So as we had applied a potential through this battery to that conductor, so this negative charge electron is moving from this negative terminal to positive terminal of that source via this body. So why this electron is moving in a particular direction? Because we had applied a force on that electron, and because of that force, electron is moving in the particular direction, and that force is known as a EMF, electromotive force. Now based on this, let's define electric current. And for that, here we are assuming a conductor. Here we have one body of a conductor, and we know that when we consider current, there are number of free electrons in that body. So these red dots which are moving in this body, which are representing free electrons. We know that at normal condition, these free electrons are moving randomly in that body. Can we call it current? No. Why? Because let's assume that if one electron is moving in one direction, then there will be another electron which will be moving in opposite direction. So that will cancel out each other. And that's why this random motion is not known as a current. But let's see that if we are applying a DC source, we are connecting a DC source to that conductor. Basically, now we are providing a force on electron in a particular direction, and because of that, now electrons will move in a particular direction. So now we have flow of electron. So electrons are moving in a particular direction, and this flow of electron is known as a current. So what is current? That is the flow of electron in a particular direction, which is known as a electric current. And if we define the amount of current, that can be defined by net charge per time, means flow of charge per time q by t, that defines value of the current. And we can define that current in ampere. Here we can observe the direction of the current of this free electron which are moving from negative terminal to positive terminal. But when we define actual current in any circuit, we define conventional current in the direction of positive terminal to the negative terminal. So this arrow is representing the direction of the conventional current. So in this chapter, wherever we are going to define the direction of the given current, we will define that current from positive to negative. So this was the electric current. Now next definition, and that is energy. What is energy? That is the ability of any body to do work. That ability is known as a energy. Again, energy can be defined in joule or maybe in form of watt into hour, means in form of power into time. Now so if we just put the value of power over here, so that will define VI into T, or you can define I square RT or V square RT. So these are the various equation of energy. And last one, that is power. So when we define electrical power, that can be defined by energy per time. Means mathematically we can say that W by T, that defines energy, and normally it is defined in watt. And we can discuss this same term by this example which is over here. Here we have one pipeline where water is flowing. So here if we calculate the rate of flow of water, that can be related to power. How much water is flowing, or at how much rate water is flowing, that rate defines the power. But if you consider in a particular time how much water is collected in that particular bucket, so that amount of water can be related to energy. So this is the example by which we can relate energy and power. And again, if we relate these terms with electrical circuit, let's discuss another example. And for example, here we have a bulb, and power rating of that bulb that is given as a 25 watt as well as the 100 watt. And let's say if we are using that bulb for 3 hours. So if we are using 25 watt bulb for 3 hours, that will consume total 25 into 3 is equal to 75 watt hour energy. So that total energy will be consumed by that bulb will be 75 watt hour. Similar way, if we are using 100 watt bulb for 3 hours, that will use 300 watt hour energy. So what is power? That is in a particular time how much energy is provided to some circuit. So this was all for today's lecture. We will meet in next lecture. So thank you for watching this video lecture, and in our next video lecture we will start basic circuit parameter like resistance, inductance, capacitance as well as their series parallel connection. So let's meet in our next lecture.